Hi friends, welcome to the channel Dinas. Here we are discussing about second part of emergency drugs MCQs. In first part we have discussed around 17 questions. Here also we will discuss 19 more questions. Before going to our topics, if you are not subscribed to our channel, please subscribe. And one more request, and please download our Android application, The Nurse Academy. We are updating daily practice questions, 10 numbers practice questions we are updating daily wise. So please download the Nurse Academy app. You can download it from Play Store. So we will move to our topic, emergency drugs MCQs. This is second part. First question, two main side effects of calcium that are important in the emergency cardiac arrest situation are. Two main side effects of calcium that are important in the emergency cardiac arrest situations are hypertension and low blood pH, hypertension and low blood pH, hypotension and high blood pH, hypertension and high blood pH. Two main side effects of calcium during the cardiac arrest. Correct answer is first one, hypotension and low blood pH. Repeated injections of calcium increase blood acidity and should be used with caution. So it will both lower the BP and lower the blood pH. So while using the repeated use of calcium injections, so we need to caution about hypotension and low blood pH. The hypertension mainly due to peripheral vasodilation, and less commonly there is a chance of bradycardia and cardiac arrhythmia. So while administering, important you need to watch for hypertension and low blood pH, and low BP is due to peripheral vasodilation, and there is a less chance for bradycardia and cardiac arrhythmias. Next question. 1 milliliter of injection atropine contains how many milligram of drug? 1 ml of injection atropine contains how many milligram of drug? 0.3 milligram, 0.4 milligram, 0.6 milligram, 1 milligram. Correct answer is 0.6 milligram. Injection 1 ml of injection atropine contains 0.6 milligram and balance 0.4 milligram contains water and sodium chloride, that is salt, for stabilizing the medicines. And one more important information, injection atropine is derived from the plant, that is belladonna plant. Atropine is derived from the plant belladonna. Third question, which drug can help stabilize arrhythmias caused by low potassium levels and digoxin toxicity? Which drugs can help stabilize arrhythmias caused by low potassium, hypokalemia and digoxin toxicity? Lignocaine, calcium chloride, magnesium sulfate, sodium bicarbonate. Correct answer, magnesium sulfate. Magnesium sulfate we can use for low potassium levels and digoxin toxicity. Arrhythmias caused by low potassium levels and digoxin toxicity. So we can use magnesium sulfate. Usually the excess magnesium loss is due to magnesium loss from body due to potassium losing diuretics, alcohol usage, that is chronic alcohol use, or sometimes due to diarrhea also. And so the arrhythmia condition that is caused due to low potassium level or digoxin toxicity can be treated with magnesium sulfate. Then fourth question, dopamine may increase renal blood flow, cardiac output, heart rate and cardiac contractility in. Dopamine may increase renal blood flow, cardiac output, heart rate and cardiac contractility in low dose, medium dose, high dose, no link with dose. Correct answer is medium dose. Dopamine may increase renal blood flow, cardiac output, heart rate, and cardiac contractility in medium dose. 1 to 5 milli, microgram per kilogram per minute IV dose, that is known as low dose. 1 to 5 microgram per kilogram per minute IV, that is low dose, it will increase urine output and renal blood flow. So low dose, it is used to increase urine output and renal blood flow. But if it is using in medium dose, that is 5 to 15 milligram microgram per kilogram per minute, that is IV infusion, that is what I am telling, 5 to 15 microgram per kilogram per minute IV infusion, that is a medium dose, that will increase renal blood flow, cardiac output, heart rate, cardiac contractility. Then we can check what is the use of high dose dopamine infusion, that is 20 to 50 microgram per kilogram per minute IV infusion, that is known as high dose. High dose may increase blood pressure and stimulate vasoconstriction, that is peripheral vasoconstriction, may increase risk of tachyarrhythmias also. While administering high dose dopamine infusion, you need to careful for tachyarrhythmias. But it is usually used in a emergency condition, so hypertension. So it will increase the peripheral vasoconstriction and that will leads to increase in blood pressure. So these are the uses of dopamine infusion, that is in low dose, medium dose and high dose infusion purposes. Then fifth question, black box warning for use of dopamine falls in patients with which disease history? Black box warning for use of dopamine falls in patients with which disease history? Black box warning, usually it is giving in that FDA setup, Food and Drug Administration, that is USA protocols. They will give some black box warning in some in certain drug covering. So that is usually used for which disease history for dopamine? Options: angina pectoria, hypovolemia, occlusive vascular disorder, ventricular arrhythmias. Black box warning is given by FDA, Food and Drug Administration, that is that drug control body is located in USA, United States of America. So they will give a black box over the cover of the dopamine hydrochloride that usually protect the patients from, correct answer, occlusive vascular disorder, because I already told dopamine will cause peripheral vasoconstrictions. So those who are already having occlusive vascular disorder, it will make further complications. A black box warning is the FDA's most stringent warning for drug and medical devices on the market. Black box warning or boxed warnings. Black box warning, also known as boxed warnings, alert the public and healthcare providers to serious side effects such as injury or death. So in the case of dopamine, it will cause peripheral vasoconstriction. So those who are having occlusive vascular disorder, they should be very careful, or it is contraindicated for patients with occlusive vascular disorder. Dopamine will cause peripheral ischemia in patients with history of occlusive vascular disease. If ischemia occurs, if you are unknowingly administer the dopamine for the patients, those who are suffering occlusive vascular disease, and ischemia occurs, prevent sloughing and necrosis in ischemic areas by infiltrating areas as soon as possible with 5 to 10 milligram of phentolamine. So if ischemia occurs, those who are having occlusive vascular disease, after administering dopamine, there is a chance of occurring ischemia If it is aqueous, means we need to immediately administer 5 to 10 milligram of phentolamine. That is a drug of choice, and it is a adrenergic blocking agent. It should be administered in 10 to 15 milliliter of saline solutions. So it should be diluted in 10 to 15 milliliter of saline and immediately infiltrate the area of ischemia. That is the treatment for ischemia caused by dopamine. Next question, dopamine is contraindicated in. So another contraindication for dopamine, pheochromocytoma, older adults, hypertension, ventricular arrhythmias. You already told occlusive vascular disease is one of the contraindication for administering dopamine, and another contraindication. Correct answer, pheochromocytoma. If we are administering a dopamine, those who are suffering pheochromocytoma, it will lead to cardiovascular collapse and potential hypertensive crisis. So these two fatal condition will occur if we are administering the patients who are suffering pheochromocytoma, because the catecholamine effects of dopamine may aggravate this condition. Catecholamine effects means that will increase the high blood pressure, that will increase the heart rate, breathing rate also will increase. These are the effects due to dopamine. So this will lead to cardiovascular collapse and a potential hypertensive crisis in patients suffering pheochromocytoma. Next question, the normal range of dopamine in blood. Serum level of dopamine level, 0 to 30 picogram per milliliter, 3 to 18 picogram per milliliter, 12 to 42 picogram per milliliter, 36 to 52 picogram per milliliter. Correct answer is option A, that is 0 to 30 picogram per milliliter. Normal range of dopamine is 0 to 30 picogram per milliliter. Next question, which drug is preferred when there is a need to improve low cardiac output? Which drug is preferred when there is a need to improve low cardiac output? Those who are working in casualty and emergency areas may know the answer. Options, dopamine, dobutamine, calcium chloride, sodium bicarbonate. Correct answer is dobutamine. Dobutamine is used to improve low cardiac output. Dobutamine primarily stimulates beta 1 adrenergic receptors. Dobutamine is preferred when there is a need to improve low cardiac output. So dopamine usually will increase peripheral vasoconstriction and then it will improve the blood pressure. In the case of dobutamine, it will increase the cardiac output. It will stimulate the beta 1 adrenergic receptors, then cardiac output, stroke volume will increase, and which will lead to increase cardiac output. Dobutamine should be avoided. Then contraindication for dobutamine administrations, the patients affected by outflow obstructions. Then second case, pulmonic stenosis or hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. In three conditions, dobutamine should not be administered. First condition, patients affected by outflow obstructions. Outflow obstructions means any obstructions in the valve or aortic vascular conditions that is obstructing the flow of blood. So that will that is one of the contraindication. Then pulmonic stenosis, and third contraindication is hypertrophic obstructive cardiomyopathy. So these are the three contraindications for dobutamine administration. Ninth question, which among the following drugs are preferred in patients with renal issues in cardiac arrest? So the patients already undergone cardiac arrest, but is a known case of renal issues. So, which drug we can administer safely? First options: dobutamine, dopamine, amiodarone, lignocaine. Correct answer is dopamine. Dopamine we can safely administer the patients having renal issues in the case of cardiac arrest, because dopamine will cause peripheral vasoconstriction, that is a primary action, and it also increase the renal blood flow. So it will improve the functions of kidney, and both it will improve the blood pressure also. So that is why dopamine is a drug of choice in patients suffering renal issues and in cardiac arrest. Then 10th question: according to 2010 ACLS guidelines, which drug is not recommended for routine use by American Heart Association? According to 2010 ACLS guidelines, which drug is not recommended for routine use of by American Heart Association? Sodium bicarbonate, calcium chloride, amiodarone, lignocaine. Correct answer is sodium bicarbonate. Sodium bicarbonate usually we are administering to correct acidosis, acidotic condition. If we are suspecting acidosis, we will administer sodium bicarbonate. But it will not usually, as a part of our cardiac arrest protocol, it will not routinely used. But in the case of suspected acidosis, we can use. At the present time, sodium bicarbonate administration in cardiac arrest is controversial. So some group of researchers are telling we can use sodium bicarbonate without any complications, but some are not agreeing with that. So it is a controversial matter, and frequency of use varies greatly between medical centers. So in some centers, they will the protocol will allow them to use sodium bicarbonate at the case of cardiac arrest, but in the majority area, they will not prefer sodium bicarbonate as a routine use. But in the case of acidosis, we can use. In the 2010 ACLS guidelines for adults published by American Heart Association, that is AHA, states that routine use of sodium bicarbonate is not recommended for patients in cardiac arrest. So that is what I have cleared here. Routine use is not recommended by AHA, American Heart Association. Then 11th question: the usual adult dose of atropine for anesthesia is? For usual dose of atropine for anesthesia, 0.4 to 0.6 milligram, 0.6 to 1 milligram, 1 to 1.2 milligram, 2.2 to 2.8 milligram. Before starting surgery, usually anesthetist will administer atropine, that is to reduce the secretions. So the dose of atropine. Correct answer here: 0.4 to 0.6. That is the first option. 0.04 to 0.6 milligram, that is the usual dose of atropine before the surgery. 12th question: 1 milliliter of injection adrenaline contains, 1 ml of injection adrenaline contains 0.5 milligram, 1 milligram, 0.3 milligram, 0.6 milligram. Adrenaline usually coming in 1 is to 1000 ratio, and it will also available in 1 is to 10,000 ratio also. So here I am asking about 1 is to 1000 ratio dose. Correct answer is 1 milligram, 1 milliliter of injection adrenaline contains 1 milligram of adrenaline. Then 13th question, which of the following is the most effective benzodiazepine for treating status epilepticus and is the treatment of choice for controlling seizures acutely? Which of the following is the most effective benzodiazepine for treating status epilepticus and is the treatment of choice for controlling seizure acutely? Midazolam, oxazepam, flurazepam, lorazepam. So I think it is a easy question. Correct answer is lorazepam. Lorazepam has emerged as the preferred benzodiazepine for acute management of status epilepticus. So it is an easy question. Then one more easy question. Drug of choice for postpartum hemorrhage. Drug of choice for postpartum hemorrhage or PPH. Oxytocin, methyl ergonovine, misoprostol, carboprost. Drug of choice for PPH or postpartum hemorrhage. So correct answer is oxytocin. First drug of choice for postpartum hemorrhage, that is oxytocin. Active management or active management in the third stage of labor involves early administration of uterotonic drug therapy, that is oxytocin, massage of the uterus and placental delivery via controlled umbilical cord tractions. So active management in third stage of labor in suspecting postpartum hemorrhage. So first we can administer uterotonic drug therapy with oxytocin. Then in the same time we can do uterus massage also. Then placental delivery. Placental delivery by controlled umbilical cord traction. So these are the three measures to prevent or reduce postpartum hemorrhage. Then postpartum hemorrhage due to uterine tone develop despite active management with oxytocin, then methyl ergonovine or methergine or misoprostol or carboprost may be used. So after administering oxytocin, it is not controlled. PPH is not controlled means that time only we can administer methyl ergonovine, that is methergine brand name, or misoprostol or carboprost. These three drugs we can use after administering oxytocin and there is no controlling postpartum hemorrhage. Then 16th question, the maximum recommended cumulative dose of oxytocin. The maximum recommended cumulative dose of oxytocin is 40 units, 20 units, 30 units, 50 units. Maximum recommended cumulative dose of oxytocin. Correct answer, 40 units. Next, 17th question. Recommended IV fluid for emergency management of severe burns in the initial 24 hours. Recommended IV fluids for emergency management of severe burns in the initial 24 hours. Normosaline, lactated ringer or RN, colloids, dextrose saline. Recommended IV fluid for emergency management of severe burns in the initial 24 hours. Correct answer is lactated ringer or RN in short. According to Parkland formula, Parkland formula we are used to, for calculating IV fluid administration in the case of burns. According to Parkland formula, initial 24 hours, Ringer lactated solutions, that is for adult, 4 ml per kilogram per percentage of burns. So calculation of IV fluids by Parkland formula in adult, that is 4 milliliter per kilogram per percentage of burns. That is in adult. In the case of children, that will be 3 milliliter per kilogram per percentage of burns. So in the case of maintenance dose in children, are ringer lactate or only using. So after calculating the 24 hours fluid, we need to administer half of the total calculated IV fluids within 8 hours. Half of the total calculated IV fluids should be administered within the first 8 hours. Then another half of the calculated fluids should be administered in next 16 hours. So next day, after the first 24 hours, next day, what was the actual total IV fluid calculated in first 24 hours? Half of the total calculated should be administered in second day. So that is the Parkland formula for administering IV fluids in the case of severe burns. The Parkland formula for the total fluids requirement in 24 hours is as follows: 4 ml multiplied by total body surface area in percentage multiplied by body weight. 50% given in the 8 hours and 50% given in next 16 hours. That is the first 24 hours. Next day, 50% of first day administered IV fluid should be administered. 18th question. In pediatric resuscitation, the usual initial dose of adrenaline is. In pediatric resuscitation, the usual initial dose of adrenaline is 0.1 to 0.03 milligram per kilogram per dose, 0.01 to 0.03 milligram per kilogram per dose, 0.06 to 0.08 milligram per kilogram per dose, 0.08 to 0.10 milligram per kilogram per dose. In pediatric resuscitation, that is an important thing. Correct answer is option B, that is 0.01 to 0.03 milligram per kilogram per dose. So each dose calculation it is given here. So we can repeat every 5 to 10 minutes according to the condition of the child. Subsequently, next dose onwards, we can administer 0.1 milligram per kilogram per dose. So according to the baby's condition only, we can increase to 0.1 to 0.1 milligram per kilogram per dose. Initial dose should be 0.01 to 0.03 milligram, but subsequently we can increase the dose by 0.1 milligram per kg per dose. Last question today. DASH is an antidote to opioids that will completely reverse the effects of an opioid overdose if administered in time. DASH is an antidote to opioids that will completely reverse the effects of an opioid overdose if administered in time. Naltrexone, Naloxone, N-acetylcysteine, Nimodipine. Correct answer, it is an easy question. Correct answer is naloxone. Naloxone blocks or reverses the effects of opioid medication, including extreme drowsiness, slowed breathing, or loss of consciousness due to opioid overdose. One more question. Sorry. The usual initial adult dose of naloxone for opioid overdoses. Usual initial adult dose of naloxone for opioid overdoses 0.2 to 0.2 milligram to 2 milligram, 0.4 milligram to 4 milligram, 0.4 milligram to 2 milligram, 0.2 milligram to 4 milligram. Correct option, option C, that is 0.4 milligram to 2 milligram. Initial dose of naloxone in opioid overdose, that should be 0.4 milligram to 2 milligram. Then this we can administer either through IV, IM, or subcutaneously. Naloxone can be administered IV, IM or subcutaneously. If desired dose is if desired response is not obtained, doses should be repeated at 2 to 3 minutes intervals. So usually naloxone is administered in the case of opioid poisoning. Patient will be unconscious or there will be respiratory depression. So if the condition is not improving, we can repeat in every 2 to 3 minutes with this 0.4 mg to 2 mg, and maximum dose we can give naloxone, maximum dose is 10 mg. Still patient is not improving with maximum dose, that is 10 mg, so the doctor or physician should be questioned about the opioid poisoning. In severe cases also, with the 10 mg of naloxone, the symptoms will reverse. If it is not reversing, means there should be another cause for the symptoms. So that is about today's video. We have discussed emergency medicines second part. Emergency medicine second part. First part we have discussed 17 questions. Then here we have discussed 19 questions. If you have any doubts, means you can ask, and please like and share. If you are if you like this video, means please click the like button and share with your friends. Thank you.